under trigonometric ratios and identities, there is a very small thing which is left off, which we call as the harmonic forms. Okay. What are harmonic forms? Let me just take a small example to illustrate this. Let us say somebody comes to you with a question. He says, hey, there is a function like this, 3 sine x plus 4 cos x. Okay. Can you, number one, sketch the graph of this? Okay. Number two, can you find the range of this function? Okay. That means, can you find out the maximum or minimum value? That is the max and minimum value of this function. Okay. So how will you solve this? How will you solve this particular problem? Now, sketching the graph is not that easy because here both sine curve and cos curve are involved, right? And please let me tell you, if you're thinking that you're going to sketch both the curves on the same XY coordinate system, that would be considered as a sum of both the graph. No, that is a wrong notion. Okay. Sketching both the function, sine function, cos function on the same coordinate axis doesn't make the graph of sum of these. Okay. So how do you sketch? That is one issue. Second thing is, how do you know the range of this function? That means, how do you find the maximum or minimum value of this particular function? Okay. No issues, Harshita. Okay. Just let me know that you are going for that. Okay, Harshita. All right. Okay, now let us understand it. Now, in this particular shape, it is difficult to do both the sketching part and finding the range of the function. So what I'm going to do here is, all of you please pay attention. I'm going to convert this to a harmonic form. The word harmonic has come as a combination of the word harmony, right? Harmony means trying to make this entire function as a single trigonometric function, either a sine function or a cos function. That means I would like to convert this function either as a constant sine x plus minus some angle, or you convert it as r, that is a constant cos x plus minus some angle. Here you can see that there has been a harmony established between the two different trigonometric ratios by converting it to a single trigonometric ratio. So if I'm able to convert f of x in either of the two form, in either of the two, I will be able to answer both of these questions very easily. Okay. Now, many people ask me, sir, why do you want to convert it to a single trigonometric ratio like a sine or a cos? Because, my dear students, managing a single trigonometric ratio is very easy, right? You can always draw the graph of r sine x plus minus alpha very easily. You can always find out the range of such a function very easily. And so is true for the second one as well. Okay. So how do I do that? First of all, what is my r? What is my alpha? And then how come this particular form will help me to sketch the function and range of the function? Let us try to understand through the very same example. Okay. Now let's see the process. Now you choose which form you want to convert it to. I'm leaving up to you. Which form you want to convert it to? You want to convert it to the first one or the second one? Okay. Setu was the first one to choose. So he said convert it to sine. Okay, fine. So now what I'm going to do, everybody please pay attention. Very, very important. The process I'm explaining you. So this 3 sine x plus 4 cos x. Okay. This number 3, this number 4. Okay. Pick it up and make it as a coordinate. Okay. So what did I do? I picked up this number 3 and I picked up this number 4 and I made it as a coordinate. Okay. Sir, are we doing coordinate geometry or are we doing trigonometry? Right, we are doing trigonometry only, but a small interesting thing I want you to observe. Let's say this is a coordinate of a point P. Okay. Now this point is, let's say, R units away from the origin. That means this distance is capital R. Okay. And this angle is alpha. Good enough. Now tell me, how can you write 3 and 4 in terms of R and alpha? You will say, sir, simple. You have asked a very easy question. This will become your R cos alpha. And this will become your R sine alpha. Correct? That means your R cos alpha is 3 and R sine alpha is a 4. Yes or no? Correct? Can you find out R from here? Yes, I can easily find out R. Just square them and add them. Sir, what are you doing and why are you doing all these things? I will explain you. Give me some time. Give me some time. Okay. So here, this will give me R square and sine square plus cos square will actually be a 1. If you want, I can write it for the time being. So R here will become a 5 because R represents the distance, isn't it? So how will you get alpha here? Alpha is very simple. Take the ratio of these two. So R sine alpha divided by R cos alpha, that will give me 4/3. And this is nothing but tan alpha is 4/3. Okay. Many of you know the answer for this. This is roughly 53-ish degree, right? Roughly 53 degree, correct? Even if you don't know it, it's not going to, you know, hamper a lot of things, right? So once you have done this, now come back to this expression. Okay. So sir, you made a coordinate out of it. You found the distance of that coordinate from the origin. You found the angle made by that particular vector. So as to say, Shalini, correct, with the x-axis. Why are you doing this? What is the reason for this, sir? Okay, let me explain the reason. Now this 3 that you have written, can I write it as R cos alpha like this? Okay, then sine x, I'll copy it as it is. This 4 that I have written, can I write it as R sine alpha? Okay, into cos x. Okay, if you see this term very, very carefully, it will remind you of your compound angle identity. You will say, "Ayyo, sir, this is nothing but R sine x plus alpha." Correct? And this is what actually I wanted. See here, this is what I wanted. Isn't it? I have achieved it. So let's put the nitty-gritties in this particular expression. So your R would actually be, or your R was actually 5 and alpha was actually 53-ish degree. Okay, let's say I'm approximately taking as 53 degree. Okay. Now, once I obtained this, is it easy for us to answer these two questions? Yes, of course, it will be easy for you to answer this question. So let us start with sketching part first. Okay. So how do you sketch the graph of 5 sine? So let's say you have now this function in front of you. How do you sketch this graph? Okay. So very simple. You'll say, sir, just draw the graph of sine x first. Okay. So let us draw the graph of sine x. I'm just making it in dotted way because this is not my final graph. So I'm just making a dotted graph. Okay. So this is your sine x graph. Okay. Of course, your top end will be 1 minus 1 in the bottom. Okay. Passing through the origin. Okay. Now let's go step by step. This is the graph of sine x. Okay. Or let me call this as y equal to sine x graph. Now, if I want 5 sine x, what do I do? Let's say next step is 5 sine x. You'll say, sir, simple. Increase the amplitude of the graph by 5 times. Right. So this whole graph will actually become extended along the y-axis, something like this. I mean, I maybe not by scale, I'm not making it. So it gets extended 5 times. Like this. Okay. So this is the graph of 5 sine x. The top end will come at 5. Bottom end will come at minus 5. In fact, I will show you this on GeoGebra also. Don't worry about it. And now finally tell me if I have to make the graph of 5 sine x, this bracket is not required, 5 sine x plus 53 degree. What do I do to this graph? What do I do to this graph? Tell me, people who are there in the bridge course transformation of graph chapter, you say, sir, shift this by 53 degree left. Absolutely, Setu. So when I shift this 53 degree left, your final graph will look like this. Pardon me if I have done some, you know, graphing error. Okay. This is how the graph is going to look like. Okay. Let me show this exactly how does it look on GeoGebra. From there, we'll be able to appreciate in a much better way. Okay. So graphing became possible. Okay. So from this graph, I'll be able to tell its range also. Isn't it? Won't I be able to tell the range? You'll say, yes, sir, it has gone to a maximum of 5. Okay. In fact, without the graph also, you can tell the range. So if I ask you, what is the maximum value this function can take? You'll say this maximum value is going to be 5. Why? Because sine of any angle, this can become a max of 1. So this whole thing will become a max of, this whole thing will become a max of 5, isn't it? Because sine of any angle can maximum become 1. Okay. 5 sine x is just the extension of the sine x graph 5 times. Its amplitude became 5 times. Think like that, Setu. Right? So it was oscillatory graph, right? It was basically a sinusoidal graph. Its amplitude became 5 times. Think as if somebody took it and stretched it along the y-axis. Okay. Similarly, what will be the minimum value of this function? You'll say, sir, it will be minus 5 because this fellow can take a minimum value of minus 1. That means overall, this function will have a minimum value of minus 5. So this graph will oscillate from a high value of 5 to a low value of minus 5. That would be the range of the graph. Okay. Now, you may get this question in your mind. Sir, can I use calculus for this if I know it? Of course, if calculus is known to you, then you don't have to rely on these methods. Okay. But sometimes, let me tell you, for these simple questions, you should not go for to calculus. Calculus is like a, you can say, it's a heavy weapon. Okay. Don't use it to kill insects. Okay. So don't use calculus, you know, for simpler questions where you can manage without it also. Now, time to show you this on your GeoGebra. Let's go to GeoGebra and see whether have I got a correct graph for this function, and does my graph actually have a range of minus 5 to 5? But before that, before I change the screen, anybody has any questions? Okay, now, if I wanted, I could have converted things in terms of cos also. Just like I converted things in terms of sine, I would have converted things in cos also. How? Other way around. I would have taken 3 as r sine alpha and 4 as r cos alpha. That way it would come into cos. Okay. But converting it to cos or converting it to sine will not have any implication with respect to the graph. There will not be any change in the graph. There will not be any change in the range. Don't worry about it. So you are free to choose whichever form you want to convert it to. So converting it to cos, you can try it out as your homework. How did you find alpha? Okay. So Noel, what did I do? I divided the, let's say I call this as the first equation and I call this as the second equation. I did 2 divided by 1 and I got this. RR got canceled and I got tan alpha. Tan alpha is 4 by 3. So alpha value, normally 4 by 3 is a very well-known angle. I don't know whether Dheeraj sir has spoken about it ever. So 4 by 3 basically corresponds to 53-ish degree. Okay, Noel, is it fine? Any questions? Acha, today I was starting my session and I got a message that some meeting is already going on this particular ID. And I realized that one of you, I don't want to name the person, had joined some trigonometry session. And that person is there in this meeting. Please do not click any old link of Zoom sent to you, even by mistake. Because as a message, I will get that there is some other meeting going on. You cannot join the meeting. Okay. So one of you had joined trigonometry meeting of the last class. Please do not do that. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Because I get a mail that so-and-so has started that meeting. Because I am the license owner of this Zoom. So, okay. I'll get a mail directly that so-and-so student has logged in and is trying to have a meeting there. Okay. All right. Anyways, let's go to the, I'll just minimize it. Yeah. So my function was 3 sine x plus 4 cos x. So 3 sine x plus 4 cos x. Okay, please have a look at it. This is the graph that we had actually drawn. See, the top end of this graph is at plus 5. The bottom end of this graph is at minus 5. Okay. And how did I draw the graph also? I will tell you what did I use to make the graph. Just a quick revision of graph and its transformation topic that we had done in our bridge course. So for making this graph, I had started with sine x graph. Okay. So all of you, please watch out the transformation from there on. I'll just mute this for timing. With special focus to Setu, you are wondering, no, what will happen when you multiply with 5? So see here. So this was your sine x. Correct. Now, if you multiply this with 5, see what happens. On the x-axis, it doesn't displace anywhere. It just becomes higher oscillations. So 5 times the oscillation. Correct, Setu? Okay. And now, finally, we displace it by some angle. So sine x plus, let me write 53. I don't know whether it's going to take degrees over here. Mm-hmm. 53 degrees. Wonderful. Okay. I think it has taken 53 degrees. All right. So this is the graph that you will finally get. I think this matches with our original graph. No? How much you displaced it here? More than 53 degrees, I believe. Okay. Anyways, let me write it as tan inverse of. Delete. Yeah, let me write it as plus tan inverse of arctan 4/3. Okay, this graph and this graph, as you can see, they both match. I'm switching both of them on together. Yeah. Do you see that? Right? So both the graphs are same graphs. Okay. So this is how you can actually sketch the graph. And of course, as I told you, you can easily find out the domain and the range. What happens if your x becomes 5x? Okay, now Setu is saying, if I make x as 5x, what will happen to the graph? You tell me what will happen to the graph. The graph is going to shrink by 5 times. You want to see? You want to see what will happen? Okay, this is a sine x graph. Let me make a 5 over here. You see that? It got shrunk by 5 times. Okay, anyways. So here is a generic theory with respect to whatever we have discussed over here. So basically, when you have been, I will just write a general form. Okay. Basically, if you have been given a function like a sine x plus b cos x, okay, you can always convert your function in terms of r sine x plus minus alpha or r cos x plus minus alpha. Okay, let me not write alpha here. Let me write a beta because there's a difference between alpha and beta values, whatever. And basis of this, you can sketch the graph. By the way, r value, I can directly tell you, r value will always be under root of a square plus b square. Okay. Alpha will depend upon which form you are actually choosing. So as per the form you are trying to convert it to. So any of the two forms you can choose as per your whims and fancies. Okay. And you can get your R will be same for both of them. It will not change. Alpha will vary depending upon which, this angle is going to change depending upon which form you are trying to convert it to. So one important thing comes out from here. Since we already know my R, I can always comment that the maximum value of this function will always be R only, isn't it? Just like in this case, our max value came out to be 5 and 5 was your R, isn't it? And your min value will always come out to be negative of under root a square plus b square, which is actually negative R. That is what we got here also as a negative 5. Okay, this is a very interesting theory that you should all note down because directly maximum minimum questions are asked on this particular concept. Okay, now a couple of things to be noted over here. many people ask this question, sir, can I apply this to, you know, any scenario? That means, let's say if it is A sine X and B cos 2X, can I apply it? Or let's say A sine 2X and B cos 5X, can I apply it? No. This formula or this direct result that you are using for maximum and minimum can only be applied when these two angles are same. If these two angles are not same, you cannot apply the direct formula. Then you have to break it up and bring it to terms which are having the same angle. We will see it through some questions. Okay, one or two questions we will take up and we'll see how it works. Okay, so please note down whatever I have written on the screen right now, because I'm going to switch my screen to the next page. I'll take hardly 10 more minutes and then I'll start with straight lines. Okay. Actually, not straight lines. We are going to start with the prerequisites to learning straight lines. Are you, sir, that important a chapter that we need prerequisites for it? Yes, of course. Okay, time to take questions. Let's take questions. Trigonometry is here. Okay, let's take this question. I know it's a proof that question, but assume that these values are not given to you. Let's say this value is hidden from you. This also value is hidden for you. Just find out what is the range of this function. What is the range of this function? Okay. Find the range. You will automatically get the range as between minus 4 to 10. Okay. Let's do this. And if you're done, just write a done on the chat box. Don't get confused. In the earlier slide, I had taken angle as X. Here they had taken angle as theta. It's just the change of the name of the variable involved. Concept remains the same, my dear. Concept is not going to change. Okay. Done. Okay. Could I write my answer as maximum value is 5 square plus 3 square under root? Can I say this is the max value? Can I say that? Will it be right to say this? Will it be right to say this? And can I say min value is negative of this? Will it be right to say this? You say, of course, no. Else it would have matched with your minus 4 and 10, right? So this is not going to work. Right? Why is it not going to work? Because as I already told you, this formula works when these two angles are same, but they're not the same, right? So you cannot apply this as the max and the min value. Had the question been just 5 cos theta plus 3 sine theta, then of course I can say maximum value is root 34, minimum value is minus root 34. But in this case, I cannot say so because these two angles are different, right? Yes or no? So what do I have to do then? Simple, you need to sit and expand this, at least the second term you need to expand and write it as cos theta cos pi by 3 minus sine theta sine pi by 3. Okay, So let's expand it even further. So it's 5 cos theta. This will be 3 by 2 cos theta. And this will be minus 3 root 3 by 2 sine theta. Am I right? Now club the cos theta terms together. So this is going to give you 13 by 2 cos theta minus 3 root 3 by 2 sine theta. Now you have this expression. Can I now say the maximum value of this expression, the max value of this expression, I can easily say will be under root of 13 by 2 whole square and 3 root 3 by 2 whole square, which is nothing but 1 by 2. 13 square is 169 and this is 27, which is I think is root 196. Root 196 is 14. Right, so max value is 3, but by the way, sorry, max value is 7. By the way, there was also a 3 sitting over here. So I should write that 3 also everywhere. And this 3 is going to remain 3. It is not going to be affected. So your max value will be this plus 3. This plus 3. This plus, and let me write 3 over here. Yeah, this plus 3. Okay. This plus three, which makes it 10. In other words, your f theta will always be less than equal to 10 because it is the max value of that particular expression. So ideally, it will be lesser than equal to that value always. Is it fine? How did it work out in this case? Any questions, any concerns, anybody? Clear? Or any doubt is there? Yeah. Okay. So can you also now figure out what will be the minimum value of this function theta? You say, sir, now you have already done all the hard work. We just have to change the sign here. So Tejaswini, let me know once you're done so that I can go down and write. Done. Okay, great. So what is going to be the minimum value of this expression? You'll say, sir, simple. All you need to do is take this as a negative of this quantity. And you don't have to redo the whole thing because we have already seen that this value comes out to be 7. So it'll be minus 7 plus 3. So minus 7 plus 3 will be a negative 4. So your f of theta will be always be more than negative 4. Okay. So let us combine these two. Let's call this as 1 and 2. So if you combine these two, we can claim that the f of theta lies between minus 4 to 10. This is what we wanted to prove. Okay. Do you think the maths is asked in NEET exams, Shalini? No, maths is not in NEET. You will not be tested on maths if you are a NEET aspirant. But if you're asking for CET, very much. This question is very much asked in CET. Okay. In NEET only PCB is tested. PCMB is not tested. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Please note this down and we'll take one last question and then we will close this particular topic for the time being, not permanently, for the time being. So we'll wait when your school will start again with trigonometry because we have trigonometric equations left to be completed and one of the most important topics for your KVPY also, which is called properties of triangles, that will also be taken up. Okay, can we go to the next page? Done, everybody? Okay, one last question we'll take up. Find the maximum and the minimum value of this expression. Achha, many times people ask me, Sir, maximum value when you are asking, why can't we do this thing? We'll make sin x also 1, cos x also 1, everything as 1. We'll make it maximum. See, in the previous example, in the first case which I gave you, if you wanted to make a maximum value out of it, right? Why can't I say, okay, the maximum value of this is 3, the maximum value of this is 4. So maximum value of this is 7. Why can't I say this? Why did my answer not match with this? My answer came out to be 5 actually. Do you remember the very first question which we took as an example? Why not 7? Can anybody explain me that? Correct, Nikhil. Absolutely. Because sine and cos cannot simultaneously become a 1. Right. That is the main reason why we had to do all these drama. Right. If sine x and cos x become simultaneously 1 at some value of x, I would happily choose that to be my, you know, position of maximum value. Or if they become simultaneously minus 1, I could happily make that as my minimum value. But unfortunately, there's a lag between sine and cos. They cannot become simultaneously 1, or they cannot become a simultaneously minus 1. Absolutely right. Correct. All right. So please attempt this question. This is the last question for trigonometric ratios and identities. And give me your response in the chat box. Okay, Shalini. Anybody else? Very good. Now here you will realize that the expression has a mix of x and 2x. But thankfully, by knowing my double angle identity, I could convert this term as 3 into 2 sin x cos x. Correct? Okay. And 2 sin x cos x is actually sin 2x. Fine? Now, just recall what I had said in the previous discussion in, I think, last to last slide. When you have the same angle sitting over here, you can use directly the formula for maximum and the minimum values. So the max value of this is simply going to be under root of 3 square plus 4 square. That's a 5. Absolutely right. Those who give that answer. And minimum value will be minus under root 3 square plus 4 square, which is minus 5. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions with respect to this? Okay, Prishan, did you realize your mistake? Clear now? Okay. Now I'll give you, we will talk about that, Setu, later on when we do calculus. As of now, let's not go into calculus part of it. One last question, I would just take this up. Find the maximum and minimum values of the following function. Let's take 2 sine square x plus 4 sine 2x plus 3. Now see here, there is a sine square x, there is a sine 2x, okay? Let's see, again, please don't use calculus even if you know it. So whatever we have done so far is good enough to solve this question. If you're done, you can write a done also. There's no need to actually sit and type out if the figures are ugly. Okay. Don't take, don't bother yourself for typing it out. Just say done. Nikhil is done. Very good. How about others? Nikhil, you are from Koramangala or HSR? Or neither? Okay, Koramangala. Let's wait for one more minute. If anybody is trying hard, please finish it off in the next 1 minute. Then we'll discuss it out. Okay, Prism is done. Shardulit thinks she's done. Good, 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 good. How about others? Noel is done. Very good, Noel. Okay, okay. Take your time, Tejasvi. Okay, let's discuss it without much ado. See, the problem here is there is a, you know, sine square sitting over here. Earlier we had us just, you know, without any power, right? And second problem is that there is an x sitting here and there's a 2x sitting over here. So what should I do then? Okay, so basically both these problems will cancel out each other. How? Let's see. Can I convert sine square x in terms of cos 2x? If yes, you will say, you'll have to recall your double angle formulas, right? So please recall, I'll just write it down over here. Recall that we had done cos 2a as 1 minus 2 sine square a, isn't it? So I can say 2 sine square a is 1 minus cos 2a, right? Put your a as x and your problem is solved actually, because this will become 1 minus cos 2x, okay? So overall, this expression simplifies out to a familiar one, which we can actually handle out. Okay, minus cos 2x plus a 4. Don't be scared by this minus sign over. It doesn't make any impact to the result that we had taken up. So the same a sine x, b cos x format will work here also. Okay, it's just that your b is now, or a, whatever you want to call it, is a negative quantity. But that doesn't change our maximum minimum results formula. So if you look at this expression, the max value of this expression will be 4 square minus 1 square under root. Okay, so this will be your maximum value of the given function. And that comes out to be, if I'm not mistaken, 4 plus root 17. Okay, the min value of this expression will come out to be negative of this and plus 4. See, this 4 is not going to change. This 4 is a constant, right? It is not dependent on any x. So 4 will remain 4 for whole of its life, okay? Only this guy is going to change depending upon the x values. So the maximum that can take is under root of 4 square plus minus 1 square under root, which is root 17. The minimum it can take is negative root 17. So your answer to the minimum value will be this, okay? So if somebody asks you for the range of the given function, you can say with confidence that it will be 4 minus root 17 to 4 plus root 17. Okay. So those who said done, did you get the same result or did you get something else? Same result. Excellent. Very good. Awesome. So for the time being, my dearest friends, I'm going to give this chapter a pause. Okay, I'm going to come back again to it with some more concepts. In fact, we have done almost only around 60% of the chapter trigonometry. 40% is still left. Okay, but we'll come back to it when you do it in the second semester. All right. Okay. All set. Everybody's fine. Happy. Okay. So let's start the new chapter.